good afternoon. Welcome to the class on supervised learning. My name is René Vidal. I'm a professor in environmental engineering, also in computer science and electrical and mechanical. And I'm going to be the instructor for this class. So I'll be giving a much longer introduction as to what this class is about in a moment. But as a matter of big high-level summary, what this class is about learning methods for discovering structure in high-dimensional data sets. So the class is going to be based upon this book that I've written. And the types of structures that we're going to be interested in really is that we're going to be given very, very high-dimensional data sets. And we would like to find low dimension. What are a few principal dimensions within data that are the most relevant for a certain learning task? So the first part of the class, which would be about a month or so, will cover discovering linear subspaces within a data set. Both well-known technique that is more than 100 years old, known as principal component analysis, many of you are familiar with, but various extensions of it that make it robust with respect to a variety of data corruptions, including missing data, outliers, noise, and so on and so forth, as well as extensions that have to do with data that doesn't live in a linear subspace, but rather in a surface, or more generally, a manifold. The second part of the class will cover cases where you have data that lies in multiple structures. This is typically common in data that is multimodal or data that comes from many classes. And in that case, it may be more appropriate to model the data not with a single manifold or with a single subspace, but rather with many of them. So we'll discuss a variety of different techniques for clustering data into multiple groups that correspond to different low-dimensional subspaces. And then I'll talk about various applications. And again, I'll give a much more detailed introduction of what this is about. So as I said, much of the material is in this book. And there are three ways you can access the book. First, you can get it an online version PDF for free from the library. And so that you just go to the link of the library for Springer. And you can download it, and that's because the university has a contract with Springer to give you access to various books. Or you can buy it directly from Springer or Amazon. But the lectures would effectively follow what is in the book. The book will be much more detailed, and the classes, I think, would be much more understandable. So I think it'll be a nice complement. So this course is a graduate level course. Occasionally, a few undergraduates have taken the class. Usually, maybe three, or I think maybe I had five last year. But by and large, it's a graduate level class. Typically, in fact, to be taken once you've had already some exposure to machine learning. That being said, much of the class will rely pretty much the background material will be pretty much undergraduate level material. So in particular, you need to be very good at linear algebra. Most of the linear algebra classes in undergraduate curriculum in the US would cover some of these basic concepts, such as range, basis, null space, eigenvalues, and eigenvectors, but they might not cover, for example, the singular value decomposition. That singular value decomposition would be essential for the class, so being very good at it is important. And I will cover, I think partly today and primarily on Friday, a very brief and fast introduction to those aspects of linear algebra that will be needed for the class. A second prior class that this class will rely on is optimization, particularly knowing what conditions for optimality in optimization are. Will rely heavily on the method of Lagrange multipliers to do optimization. Many of the problems that will show up are convex optimization problems, but there will be a few that are non-convex. And again, being very good at formulating optimization problems, taking derivatives, setting them to zero, and solving for the optimum would be important for this class. And the last is probability and statistics. Some of the models that we will cover are generative models, and therefore they will involve some calculations with random variables, expectations, and so on and so forth. In particular, knowing what maximum likelihood estimation is, that's something not typically covered in an introductory class to statistics, but in various other classes you might have heard of the maximum likelihood principle and expectation maximization. The reason being that, for example, there are probabilistic versions of PCA based on generative models, so we will go through how to do inference and learning for those type of models. Again, you don't need to have a graduate level probability statistics. The undergraduate would be sufficient, but you probably need to be very good. And there will be some programming assignments that you need to code. I've written here MATLAB just because it's the easiest. But I guess using Python or something else. I think by and large, it would be whatever the TA can grade should be fine. Having taken the previous or the undergraduate level machine learning class is not necessary, but it would evidently be a plus. By and large, the undergraduate machine learning class already takes linear algebra optimization probability statistics and puts them together for solving classification problems and some basic clustering algorithms such as k-means is typically covered. So in this class, we would use k-means and build upon more advanced clustering techniques. Again, I'm going to be teaching everything. It's just that if you've never heard anything about machine learning in your life, it might be a little bit fast for you. And that's why I'm saying that having prior exposure is a plus. So the class will meet Mondays and Fridays in this room this time. I will be away some weeks throughout the semester. I have to travel internationally. And so I was hoping that we could make some makeup classes. And I was guessing that since most classes are Monday and Friday, Monday and Wednesday, the Wednesday at 12 noon might be free. And we might be able to do that in those specific dates that I've set here. If that doesn't work, send me an email and I'll do some poll and try to schedule at a time that is convenient for everybody. But I'll probably do so maybe a week or two from today, just because many of you might no longer take the class. And so I don't want to have an intersection of schedule that makes it more complicated. I'd like to do it just with the people who are ultimately going to take the class. But a priori, what I'm saying here is that I was planning to use some of the Wednesdays for makeup classes. So if you have a major conflict with Wednesday at the same time, then this is my office and my email if you need to contact me. That is the website, but actually maybe I'll modify it in real time. I think if you add teaching and learning 17, hopefully you will get to the class website. Let me see if that is the case. So that's the class website. Okay, so in the class website, I will be posting any announcements. I'll be posting the homeworks, the exams, the solutions, so everything you can find there. There will be a TA. I think it may have been chosen already, but I don't have the full information, so I'll provide it in the next lecture once I have it. Then the grading. There will be homeworks pretty much every other week. One year, I think I gave maybe too many and the students complained, so I think it was maybe 8. And last year, I gave only 2 and the students complained that it was too few. So I was going to do something in between. So I think it'll be 5 or so roughly every other week. In the class website, in fact, I probably already put 6 with dates, so I can even show you what's in there. So you just go to the website. That's my expectation for now. And I'll try to keep those dates, but you know, it's not always possible to go perfectly on time. I remember last year we had so many cancellations due to snow. And that was one of the reasons why I couldn't give any homework at the beginning, and then they ended up being too late. So if the weather cooperates and we are on time, those would be the dates. Here. So there will be homeworks roughly every other week. Most of the homeworks, if you look at the book, there are exercises in there already. And actually, pretty much all of the homeworks will be taken as exercises from the book. The exercises are, by and large, analytical exercises. But there will also be assignments where I'll give you a data set, and I'll ask you to code the algorithms that we are covering in class and evaluate them on those data sets. The data sets will always be faces, and so I'll ask you to run algorithms on recognizing faces and clustering faces. There'll be two midterms that will cover sort of the first half of the class and then the second half of the class. Each one of them will be an hour and 15 minutes. The first one will be in class on March 31st. This is the week after the spring break. And the other exam will be on the day that is allocated for the exam for this class, which is currently May 12th. I believe it's from 9 to 12 noon. And so what I plan to do is to use the first hour and 15 minutes for a short exam. Again, it's not going to be comprehensive. It's only going to be the second half. And then the rest for project presentations. I have usually let the students choose a project that can be done in groups of three people. The number of people, I think, depends on the size of the class. I think one year I had maybe 40 students, so I let the groups be very large because I don't want to grade too many projects. Last year, maybe the last time, there were a little bit less, so some groups were two, some groups were three. So we'll play it by ear, but approximately, let's say, three people. I might try something new. In the past, I've just let everybody do a different project, whatever they choose, but I haven't thought it through fully yet, but I was thinking maybe to just give a single project for everybody and do a competition of who does best on the project. I did that once in computer vision and it worked out beautifully. In computer vision, I gave a project that was, gave them a video of an intersection in India that was wild, crazy, with cars and bikes and people and cows and animals and all crossing. And the goal was to detect, track, and segment and recognize as many objects as possible in the video. And so that can be a very open-ended problem where every student can do it with different techniques from the class. But all of them have the same objective, and I found it that the students got more engaged and it was also easier to evaluate and compare. But I'll let you know once I decide what the style of the project will be. But I guess I just gave you an example. Otherwise, in the class webpage, I put what I did for last year, just to give you examples of what people did in the last year. So some people did a theoretical project, which was to take an existing algorithm for which the theoretical analysis was lacking and try to complete that theoretical analysis. Other students, what they did was to take multiple algorithms from the class and do a comprehensive evaluation and comparison of the performance of those algorithms. And what other students did was to take maybe some application from their own research, and it usually varies. Some students do computer vision, some students do speech and language, some students do medical imaging, some students might be doing neuroscience. And they all had their own problems for their research, and they took methods from the class and applied them, expanded them, adapted them to their problem. So just to give you a contrast a little bit of what the type of projects can be. So going back to this. Again, the projects, will be worth 30%, and there'll be a report and a presentation due at the end of the semester, and the due date will be the same, May 12th. And the presentation will be done in the second half, so from 10:15 to 12 noon on that date. It's always important to be honest, so taking the code posted on the web from someone else and claiming it as yours is not okay. Every time you use someone else's code, you need to acknowledge the source where it came from. So by and large, you should not take credit for anything that is not that you've something that you've done. The homeworks will be strictly individual, so you're not supposed to be talking or asking others, except maybe in office hours, where you will be with me or the TA. And the projects can be done jointly, in groups of three, as I said. And this is just the official statement regarding honor code from the university, so I'll just read it. The strength of university depends on academic and personal integrity. In this course, you must be honest and truthful. Ethical violations include cheating on exams, plagiarism, reuse of assignments. So again, you cannot download previous homeworks or previous exams and just take the solutions. You have to do them by yourself. Improper use of internet. I think I already gave the example of taking the code. Unauthorized collaboration would mean, for example, doing jointly the homeworks if they're supposed to be individual. Modifying assignments to change grade, etc., etc. Okay, so let me now begin with what the class will be about.
Question, will all of these be available on the website, your lectures?
Everything that I'm talking about today, it's already posted. A good percentage of the lecture will be done on the board. And so I'm trying to get that recorded so that it can be watched after. But the I don't necessarily have slides or lecture notes. I've got the book and then I'll write on the board. And so you will probably need to take notes. But anytime that there are slides, I'll post them. So we live at this moment in time, I think a very exciting time, where the availability of data has just exploded in all fields in science and engineering. And this is true in the case of engineering all over the place. It's true in computer vision, where we take more and more pictures every day. It's true in medical imaging, where most procedures that when you go to see the doctors involve taking one medical image. It's true in robotics, where robots are acquiring data. And I think the example of autonomous cars is, I think, well known in the way that Street View was built by having a car drive throughout the world and take all of the images as well as 3D data from the world is another example. And it is true in bioinformatics, where now you can get, you know, for $100, I think, the coding of the gene expression for yourself. So in the case of images and videos, which is one of the biggest sources of data today, this plot shows the number of images that are taken every year, starting from the first picture that was done in 1826 in France. If you go to Wikipedia, you will see that that picture, I don't remember, but it probably took maybe 24 hours to take just a single picture because it was not done digitally as it's done today, right? So you had all of these materials that they were sensitive to the light, and actually you would actually get a 3D sort of little deformation that was correlated to what that picture was. But ever since, due to dramatic advances on electronics and cameras, it today is just instantaneous. And so we've gone to, I think this is 2011 data, 380 billion pictures taken every year. And the top curve is all photos, and this is analog photos that obviously we don't take anymore. This is the availability of these pictures has grown dramatically due to social networks. So there are over 350 million photos taken, uploaded into Facebook alone every day. And this, in 2012, it was estimated that there were 3.8 trillion photographs that had been taken. And the main problem is that it's growing at an exponential rate. So just 10% of all of the pictures taken in the humanity were just taken the previous year. So this just keeps composing. This is also true for video. I think these statistics are actually outdated maybe 3 or 4 years ago, but I think today it's like something like 300 hours of video that are uploaded to YouTube every minute. And 5 years ago, Cisco had made the prediction that by the end of this year, 90% of the traffic in the internet would be video game. So I think this, just by contrast, right, when we look at research, this is the largest data set used today in images for actually doing recognition of objects. And it's a data set that has 14 million images and 22,000 object categories, out of which only 1,000 are manually annotated, so that we can use that for training supervised learning algorithms that do recognition. But the cost of manually annotating, and I think this is one example, this is a database with 1 million images, and only 1,000 categories are annotated out of the 22,000, and that is because annotating data, it's incredibly burdensome. And in this particular case, the annotation is simply take one picture and then say, you know, that is a picture of a t-shirt. And so there's just one label that is given to every image. But as you can imagine, in many other learning tasks, the number of labels that need to be given is significantly larger. Think about speech, where you want to annotate every word or every phoneme that is being said, and that is changing as a function of time. So the number of labels is just a sequence of labels, in fact. Or think about segmenting images, where you would like to give a different label to every pixel, and you have to have a person manually marking. So imagine now that I gave you millions and millions of images, and I ask you segment each one of them, and for each one of them annotate which object is present in that pixel. That would eventually be a daunting task. And that is actually what motivates a little bit the idea of doing unsupervised learning, which is, how do I learn about structures that are present in the data without having to have manual annotation? So that is the key distinction between supervised versus unsupervised methods. And as I said, this class will be primarily about unsupervised methods, where we don't need to have labels, yet we can still discover structure in the data. Now, I motivated this so far with natural images, but this is also true in the case of medical images. So these are a few statistics of the number of procedures. This is only in the US, and there are already about 400 million procedures every year that involve taking at least one medical image. And the number of medical archives is increasing on the order of 20 to 40% every year. And so again, there is dramatic need for storage, sharing, and in fact, there's been tremendous progress in the last 50 years on how one should collect, store, and share, and compress these very big dimensional data sets. But I think the fundamental challenge of this century in machine learning would be really our ability to make predictions and interpret those massive data sets, which currently cannot be done by hand, and it's very hard to annotate, and so that is what motivates the need for automated methods. So in the 1960s, there was this beautiful paper written where maybe we had a lot of mathematical methods. Physics had been revolutionized the first half of the last century. And information theory was beginning to revolutionize the second half, which eventually led to the current information theory. You know, all of the revolution in communications was thanks to those developments in the 1950s, and later on also developments in computing. At that time, many of these developments were because you could write equations and write models and make a mathematical formalization of all of these principles from physics, from information, and so on and so forth. And so there was this paper talking about the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in the natural sciences. So today, because it's become so much easier to acquire data, we are faced in science with this phenomena where rather than making a hypothesis and try to write down a physical model and then try to validate it with an experiment, which was the traditional way that science was done, now we already have the data. And sometimes we start asking questions about the data once it's been collected. And this led to the directors of research in Google to write this paper. I think this is maybe now 2000. I should have written the data for that. Talking about the unreasonable effectiveness of data. And of course, I think the truth is not in either camp, but rather on being able to both have models of the physical world, but as well as a lot of these models can be learned and derived from data. So this class is a little bit more on the second camp because we will just have the data that's been collected and we will hypothesize certain types of geometric or statistical or maybe topological models that are appropriate for modeling that data. And then we'll have techniques for learning those models from training examples. But I always want you to keep in mind that for application in biology and applications in the natural sciences, interpreting what those models predict is always important. And there is a little bit of a gap today in between models that are, model-driven versus data-driven. So specifically now, getting into this class, what type of models are we going to be working with? So as I mentioned earlier, the first kind of models would be affine subspaces. So the hypothesis will be that even though the data is complex and very high dimensional, it can be well approximated by a linear or affine subspace of much smaller dimension. And I always like to motivate this with this example that is here at the bottom, which is going to be a running example throughout the class. And in fact, many of the homeworks, I'll ask you to evaluate methods on this data set. And so this is a data set where it's a collection of pictures taken from different individuals. They are nicely cropped so that they only cover the face. So, and they're nicely organized by pose. So in this particular case, these are all frontal pictures. Okay. And so in this particular case, the main change across the different pictures is that the light is from a different, has a different angle with the person. Right. And so the idea is that the dimension of each such image could be very large. It could be 100 by 100 or 1,000 by 1,000, whatever the size of your favorite picture might be. But think about, 10 to the 6 could be a typical dimension for an image. So a large number of pixels. And now it's always the same person. And so if the light was constant and the point of view was constant and that person was, fully static and didn't smile, didn't change glasses, nothing, then that picture would always be the same. So if I were to put these as columns of a matrix, they would all be equal to each other. So this would be a rank one matrix. But here, there are variations, and those variations are because the light's in different locations. So I don't want to get into the details. This is very introductory. And in any case, this is not a computer vision class. So just believe me that there is being shown from methods in computer vision that if you now put together all of the faces of the same individual under different light variations, they can be well approximated by a low-dimensional subspace. The simplest model for doing so, it says that the subspace should have dimension 3. Why 3? Is because really the intensity that in a particular location of the face is always sort of the dot product between the light that is coming and the normal to the surface. So therefore, the entry at every you think of this as a matrix where one dimension is the pixels and the other dimension is the different pictures, right? Then for each pixel and each picture, I always have a dot product between the light than the normal to the surface. And so that's why it should be rank 3. That is a good approximation for, you know, when what is typically called in computer vision a Lambertian assumption, which means that you don't have specular points. For example, here, the tip of the nose, it's not always in the same location, right? It depends a little bit, you know, if the light is coming from this way, the specular point will be on this side, and that moves a little bit. So those are violations to the model. That means that in reality, this subspace assumption will be violated. And so we have, in reality, a subspace with some corruptions. And that's what's going to be the theme of it. But anyhow, what I wanted to say is that this this is one concrete example for the for this affine subspace model. But even though the ambient dimension for the data is 10 to the 6, the dimension in practice is just 3 dimensions. So the question is, how do I take these images that live in a sub, in an ambient space of dimension 10 to the 6 and reduce it to the 3 relevant dimensions? Then, why do the subspaces need to be linear? That's one potential question. So another aspect is, what if they're curved spaces? And so what would happen is, going back to the example of faces, if I now freeze the illumination condition, and all what I do is that I rotate my face, right? Again, the faces might be 10 to the 6 in dimension. But the fact that all of the pictures will just correspond to moving, you know, just rotating, this means that it's really like moving in a circle. So it should really be one intrinsic dimension where it really matters and should be able to characterize all of those pictures. So how, given a collection of pictures of a single individual, let's say 1,000 pictures, all of them identical except that I'm just rotating the face of the individual, how do I discover that, in fact, it's just a circle? And that for each point in the circle, I generate an image that corresponds to that orientation of the person. And so that area of machine learning is called manifold learning. And it precisely it aims to, given a lot of data, how do I discover these nonlinear structures that are present in the data? The next type of model we're going to use is this model of a union of subspaces. And that is because, in reality, when we're given data, I could have a situation where multiple classes are present. In the case of faces that I've talked about today, I could have faces of two different individuals. Individual 1 will generate one linear subspace of dimension 3. Individual 2 will generate another subspace of dimension 3. So the data will lie in multiple subspaces. So one potential task would be, you know, you take all of the pictures that you have in your laptop from all your vacations. You know that iPhoto these days is able to do detection of faces, right? Could you cluster all of those pictures in, I don't know, 1,000 groups that correspond to the 1,000 people that show up in your pictures? How do you do that? So if, and this is a big if, all of the variations on those pictures were only due to illumination and they were all frontal pictures, then you could do it by clustering according to multiple subspaces, and there will be one different subspace corresponding to each one of the individuals. So now, zooming in the first part, which will cover this method called PCA, we will cover the geometric version of it, which is, given a cloud of points, how do I fit a subspace to it? But we'll cover also statistical versions of it, which are, for example, given a cloud of points, how do I find the principal directions, or the directions in the data that have the most variance? And this problem is incredibly old. In fact, the first, they didn't call it PCA at the time, but in 1973 already, Beltrami and Jordan, who are two mathematicians, had already discovered that this could be done by doing low-rank approximations of matrices. But the person who really formalized this was Hotelling in 1933. And it can be done today using the singular value decomposition. So you take a matrix, you factorize it, and that will give you the basis for the subspace. The application in phase classification, I already described it, so I'm not going to go over it again. But I want to point out that in reality, data never lies perfectly on a subspace. And in the case of phases, what are the types of corruptions that you could have? What if someone is wearing glasses? That will change. So then in that particular case, if all of the examples you have were with the person without glasses, and now you have one example of the person with glasses, what does that mean? It means that most of the face is not corrupted, but some subset, a few pixels have been corrupted. Only those pixels where the glasses lie. The same thing is true when you put scarves. So what that means is that I need to do PCA, but I take the data and some pieces of the entries of it have been corrupted and the pixel values have been replaced by something completely different. So there is a subspace out there, but pretty much every point in that subspace, if every picture has been corrupted, pretty much every point in that subspace, entries of it are fully corrupted. So you don't see the subspace anywhere, and how do you discover that, that there is one there? The light variations is not a problem, but pose variations is a different topic. So here are some examples. It could also be the case that entries are missing. So suppose that I give you a picture, and now I tell you that half of the entries, I didn't collect the values. Okay, this would be probably a very bad camera. But there are other examples where this actually happens all the time. I think Netflix is one of them. How many of you have used Netflix? Okay. So how many movies have you rated in Netflix? 0, 1, 3, 5. Has anyone rated more than 10 movies? Okay. Has anyone rated more than 20 movies? 30? How many have you rated?
I don't know how many, it's a lot.
100? Okay. How many movies are there in Netflix? Have you rated them all?
Don't have that one.
So suppose that Netflix had 1 million movies. Is that unreasonable? Okay. Suppose that he is rated 100. Suppose there was someone else who rated 1,000. It's still 1,000 out of 1 million have been rated. So if I look at the matrix of ratings, where, you know, let's say the rows are movies and columns are users, right? And for each movie, then I have a rating from the user. How many of the entries of that matrix have been filled in? If every user has been filled in 10, 20, 100, a very small fraction, okay? So you could conjecture that the matrix of ratings has to be low rank. Why could you conjecture that? Well, you could say the number of topics of all possible movies that are going to be generated is not that many. And maybe in some feature vector representation, movies that are of the same genre are linear combinations of each other. Okay? If that is the case, I would only have as many different movies or I would have multiple subspaces, each one corresponding to a different genre, right? So the fact of the matter is that there might be 1 million movies, but how many of them are linearly independent, it might be much fewer. And so it may be a low rank matrix. And so I could ask the question, given the fact that very few ratings are available, how could I complete and figure out what the missing entries are? And therefore being able to provide you, when you're using Netflix, with which movies you're gonna like. And so you probably have seen that it says, because you watch X, you will probably like Y. Have you seen that? Yeah. So how is that done? That is really a low rank matrix completion algorithm that is really taking data that is very, very high dimensional, in this particular case, movies. Then, or actually in this particular case, the data at the end of the day is just the ratings. Number of users of Netflix times number of movies. That's the size of it. Assuming that it's low rank and having a algorithm that will automatically figure out what the missing values in that matrix are. This is the case where the entries are corrupted. I think I mentioned that in the case of faces. You put glasses, a fraction of the entries are corrupted. So suppose again that you had a perfectly beautiful matrix that is low rank. What is that? All of your pictures from a front of view are the varying illumination. Let's say you have lots of them. Okay. But now, the reality is that you start and you go ahead and you correct every picture. So what you observe is a matrix like this, where lots of pixels of each picture have been corrupted. Could I go back and decompose that corrupted data matrix as the sum of one that is low rank, and therefore it would have perfect pictures, plus another matrix that has all of the corruptions? And how can we do that? It's going to be the robust PCA topic that we'll look at: PCA with missing entries, PCA with corrupted entries. And the last one is outliers. Say that one user of Netflix was malicious and just started to rate all of the movies at random, and you cannot predict what he does. Because he's in there and you don't know that that person is malicious, it could corrupt all of your predictions for all of the other users, and you don't want that to happen. So you want to detect that that person is putting random ratings and remove it from your estimate of the substance. Likewise, suppose that you have all pictures of faces, but all of a sudden, you know, as I said, you need to detect faces and images. The detector will make mistakes, so you will have detections that correspond to background or something else. Could you detect automatically faces versus non-faces? That would be another example. The next example is, what if a linear model is not good enough, and I need to discover a nonlinear structure inside the data? Let me give you a concrete example. So this is now, I think, maybe a statue. And the lighting condition is changing. So it's the same example as before, but also the pose of that statue is changing. And now, I don't remember how many, but let's say 1,000 such pictures were taken. And one manifold learning algorithm that we will cover in the class was run with the following hope. The hope was that the data was really in some sort of manifold, or maybe this might be the example. And I am able to figure out a nonlinear warp that completely flattens the data, but preserves the local structure. What do I mean by preserving the local structure? So that red point over there and most red points, so this is sort of color-coded in this dimension, right? So that, you know, all of this is red and is going to yellow and is going to blue, with the idea being that all of the dark red points end up here, all of the dark blue points end up there. And imagine in fact here that you have that situation that that red point is not too far from that blue point. So you would like an algorithm that is able to automatically figure out the nonlinear structure and not make connections with points that are actually very far apart. Because that red and that blue, if I traverse the manifold in this way, they're very far. Okay? Where could actually that happen? How could it be the case that two things end up being close in the feature space, yet they correspond to very different things? In the case of pictures, that can actually happen, and it can happen actually with lighting conditions, because if there is no light, all of our pictures will be black. And so all of the classes from different individuals, and so it could be the case that a picture of myself and a picture of Chong are identical when there is very little light, or that the distance between our pictures is very small when there is very little light, versus the distance from a picture of myself to another picture of myself with different lighting conditions. So that is the type of nonlinearity that I'm trying to talk about here, that sometimes you end up with two data points being, you think they're close according to the Euclidean distance, but if you actually look at the structure of the data, they can be very far apart. Okay? And so being able to do this well and robustly is a key challenge. So anyhow, the goal is there is nonlinear structure on the data, and I want to flatten that manifold. And once I flatten it, maybe I'll have two main dimensions that are the most important for that data set. So this was done here. And now you have the x and the y axis that correspond to the two main dimensions that were automatically discovered for this nonlinear data set. And so when you when you look at the variation in this direction, right, what you see happening is that the pose is changing. Right? Here, the person is facing to the left. Here, is facing to the right. And the y-axis, pretty much, they're all left-facing images, but the lighting conditions are very different. So even though, in this particular case, the linear model is not applicable, the algorithm, in a fully unsupervised manner, was able to discover that the two main variations in this data set, rather than being 10 to the 6 variables, there are two key variations. One is changes in light, the other one is changes in pose. And this is with no labels whatsoever. This is another example where these are handwritten digits taken from the US Postal Service of, you know, when people write zip codes. And everybody writes a number one and a number two slightly differently. So these are not all, but a large number of the pictures for number two. So what you can see is, as you move from left to right, that in one case, the bottom articulation of the number two is changing, right? On the left here, I don't know what Nancy is here, right, is relatively flat, while here you're starting to do the loop as you go from there. While when you go here now, the top down articulation. So in other words, what I'm trying to say is that it is possible to design algorithms that without any supervision are able to discover the principal modes of variation of the data, whether they lie on a linear subspace or whether they lie on a nonlinear map. So, okay, so PCA might just be the first 3 weeks, and then robust PCA will be all of February and maybe early March. And we will finish, I think, hopefully by spring break, we'll finish all with the nonlinear manifolds as well. So after spring break, we will go from one subspace or one manifold to many of them so that we can model multiple classes. And so abstractly, the mathematical problem we will tackle is this problem of given a cloud of points that lies in multiple subspaces. What you want to do now is more difficult than before. Before, finding that subspace was good enough. Now, you can ask, well, how many subspaces are there? Can I cluster the data into different groups that correspond to the different subspaces? Also, there is always the problem of dimensions. Different subspaces might have different dimensions. Also, there will be challenging because there are model selection issues. Like, maybe I can fit all the data with one subspace of very large dimension. Or maybe I can fit every data point with a line. And so I have lots of subspaces, each one of being of very low dimension. So how do you automatically discover the right trade-off of how many subspaces and what their dimensions are, etc.? It's challenging because it's sort of chicken and egg. If I knew which point belongs to which group, I could probably do the same techniques like PCA or robust PCA, any of our favorite techniques from the first half of the class. If I knew the subspace for each group, I'd probably assign every point to the closest and I could do the clustering. The challenge is that I don't know the clustering and I don't know the subspaces. So this is one of those classical chicken and egg problems. And what that translates mathematically is that that leads to non-convex optimization problems, where we typically need to alternate between solving for the segmentation given the models and solving for the models given the segmentation. And so the analysis of such non-convex problems is typically very hard, and we will cover some of that as we go through. And again, the same issues that I mentioned earlier. The data will never perfectly fit a union of subspaces, so it'll be corrupted by noise, it'll be corrupted by missing entries, it'll be corrupted by outliers. And so we will cover also how algorithms need to be modified to adjust to those cases. There are lots of applications for this. The example of clustering faces and the varying illumination, I already mentioned it. But this can also be used for compressing data or for segmenting images. So for example, suppose that you divide an image into multiple patches, as I've done here. Now look at different patches and think, for example, of all patches that fall into the zebra region, okay, where you have a lot of stripes. So you could hypothesize that all zebra patches even though they might be of dimension 1,000, you know, they could be, or 100 by 100, some large dimensional vector. All of those patches within a single image, they could be modeled by a subspace. So they could be low rank. If I put together all of those patches into a matrix, the rank might be low. But the patches for the grass might be in a different subspace. The patches for the water might be in a different subspace. So if I just take an image, compute all the patches, and now run a subspace clustering algorithm, I may be able to segment the image into different regions that corresponds to different types of patches. One other application is taking videos and segmenting videos that have many objects that are moving. So in this particular case, I guess you see two cars that are moving. You might not see, but also the camera is moving over. So the reality here is that there are three different rigid body motions. What you can do is use computer vision techniques to detect and track a collection of points in the video. And so each one of those crosses, the yellow and the red and the blue crosses, are points in the image that just were tracked throughout the video. So now what you have is these trajectories. You have a collection of trajectories. And so the dimensions of this might now be number of trajectories, and in the other dimension you have maybe the dimension of the trajectories, which is the number of frames, typically. Maybe times two, because each trajectory has two coordinates. Okay. So can I take all of the trajectories extracted from a video that correspond to different moving objects and cluster them automatically into multiple groups that correspond to the car one, car number two, and the bike? And how do I do that? So as it turns out, because these trajectories come from rigid body motions, you can model them with a low-dimensional subspace. I'm not going to get into details, and for simplification, I'm going to say it is of dimension 3, and again, because it has to do with three-dimensional trajectories. And so, even though this matrix might be very large, you know, number of trajectories by number of frames, the rank of it is 3 if there is only one moving object. And therefore, if there are many moving objects, the rank will be 9 in this case, that you have three moving objects, each one of the dimension 3. So that's another application. This is another one where now you would like to separate an image or a video here. This is fire in front of water. And so what you do is that you look at each individual pixel. And as a function of time, because this is sort of a deforming type of motion, you describe some trajectory. It's not a sinusoid, but think of it as if it was, okay, approximate. So as it turns out, how many, all of you took differential equations at some point in your life, right? Anyone has never taken differential equations? You took linear differential equations, which is the easiest. So it is possible, in fact, to think of these trajectories as living in a subspace, the subspace generated by the exponentials corresponding to that linear system. And so the idea here is that the parameters of the differential equation corresponding to fire versus the parameters of the differential equation corresponding to the background are different, and so you have different subspaces. So if you just fit multiple subspaces to these temporal trajectories of intensities, you can separate the water from the fire, because the dynamics are different. And this is a last example, not from this last year election, but 8 years before, because you can see Hillary and Obama. This was during the primary season back then. So the idea is that if you look at this video, you see sometimes the two of them together, sometimes you get a side view, sometimes you see the public, sometimes you see the interviewer, sometimes you see Hillary only. So if I take the whole video, I can divide it into a sequence of events. And each event is semantically well-defined. But in addition, you know, there are some variations, like Hillary is moving a little bit. But the idea is some of them are iterative, and alternate, given the subspaces bonding to the same event, can be well approximated by a low dimensional subspace. So if I take all of the frames of the video, and the goal is to divide it into all of these events that are happening, I can run this subspace clustering algorithm, because each event will correspond to a different subspace. Okay? And we will see how we can do that. How do we do that? There are lots of methods that have been developed over the last 15 years to do subspace clustering. Some of them are iterative and alternate, given the subspaces, find the segmentation, given the segmentation, find the subspaces. And we'll cover those. Some of them are generative models, probabilistic generative models. And so that is where we'll write down the equations of the generative model. It will have latent variables. It will have latent variables that correspond to which group does it come from. Other latent variables will correspond to, well, the low dimensional subspace structure. And so we need to do expectation maximization type algorithms to learn those models. We will also cover some techniques that are purely algebraic, that they just look at the geometry of unions of subspaces and say, well, algebraic geometry can be used in here, polynomials and so on and so forth. But we'll primarily focus on the current state-of-the-art methods that are all based on convex optimization, particularly methods based on sparse and low-rank representation, compressed sensing, that are currently being used for clustering these very high-dimensional data sets. Okay. So that is just an overview of the method. All right, maybe this is a good time for any questions? That sort of ends the introduction of the whole class before I get into the linear algebra background. Any questions? Okay. So I'll begin with a brief review. So so just eigenvectors and eigenvalues. So it is the facts. So Ax is equal to the x. In this particular case, let's say that A is an M by M matrix, and so lambda can in general be a complex number, and X in general can be a complex vector. Okay. So what is an eigenvector? Is a complex valued vector that has the property that if I apply the matrix to the vector stays the same, except that it gets multiplied by a certain scale. The way in which eigenvalues and eigenvectors are computed is that one needs to compute the so-called characteristic polynomial. And this is a polynomial on lambda of degree n. Maybe the other way around, lambda I minus a. That's how eigenvalue is computed, and because this is a polynomial, it can only be written as such. And because of that, there are n different solutions to this set of equations. they're the end roots of the polynomial, and they can be different, they can be repeated, lots of things can happen. And then for each one of those eigenvalues, we can solve these. Now, once lambda is fixed, solving for x is really solving a linear system, and we can find the eigenvalues. Particular matrices that will be of importance here are symmetric matrices. So if A transpose is equal to A, that would be one matrix that would be of great interest. And these matrices have particular properties that will be of importance. So if A is symmetric, then the eigenvalues of A are real. Okay. That's an important property that we will use. Then another property that we will use is that a matrix is positive definite if x transpose ax is strictly bigger than 0 for any vector x that is different from 0. And another result that we will use is that matrix, and we will write this as A being with this curly bigger than sign. Okay. And so we will use this property that a matrix is positive definite if and only if the eigenvalues of that matrix are strictly positive. That's another important property. So, as an example, if I give you a matrix B, given B, comma, the matrix A, which is given by B transpose B, is positive definite. Actually, this is going to be positive semi-definite. Where the word semi, which I didn't write here, but I'll add it, if I write semi-definite, I would add here that semi is denoted by that extra thing that I'll put there, and then I'll put bigger than or equal to 0 there. Okay. So it's like the difference between being bigger than 0 versus being bigger than or equal to 0. And that's the difference between positive definite and positive semi. So let me do the proof, because it's very simple in this particular case. What I need to show is that x transpose ax, right? The definition says you need to show that x transpose ax is bigger than or equal to 0. So the way you show that in this particular case is because you know a, so you get x transpose b and x. And this thing is the same as the norm of bx squared. And evidently any norm is bigger than or equal to 0. Okay. Okay, so another property of matrices that we're going to be using refers to the trace of a matrix. And the trace of a matrix is just the sum of A's I. Okay. And interestingly, that is also equal to the sum of the eigenvalues. So this is another result. So the trace of a matrix is the sum of the diagonal entries and is equal to the sum of the eigenvalues. Another quantity we're going to be using is the so-called Frobenius norm for the matrix. And that Frobenius norm is the sum of aij squared over I and j. So it's really like, take a matrix, think of it as a vector. Just spell out all of the entries of it in a gigantic vector and take the norm, sum of the square of the entries. What is interesting is that this has two properties. One is that it's equal to the sum of the square of the eigenvalues. Maybe this lasts. I shouldn't say this. This is the sum of the squares of the singular values, which I have not covered yet. I take it back. What is true is that this can be written in terms of the trace as the trace of a transverse type. Anyone did not know this last property? Or everybody knew all of these properties already at this point? Well, you're not responding either way, so I don't know. Anyone didn't know this last property that the Frobenius norm square of a matrix is the trace of A transpose F? You did not. So I'll prove it. Okay, so you do know that if I have two matrices, right, and I take the product of them, maybe I should write it as. So let me do it. I'm just doing this. What is the ij entry? In a sense, is what is the definition of matrix product? I have two matrices. I take the product of them and I compute the ij entry. You remember how you do it? Right, you've got this matrix and you've got the other matrix, and all you need to do is that you take one row and you do dot product with a column, right? Remember that? So that is really that you take a I k and b a j and then you sum. Right? Because this entry here is going to be AIK, and the corresponding one is going to be BKJ. Okay? I take the ith column of the matrix, the jth column of the other, and I do the dot product. And the dot product is the sum of the products. Is that clear? That you probably remember. And this sum is over K. Okay, so that quantity that I've written there is just the ij entry of the product of two matrices. So, if I specialize these to A transpose A, and I ask you what is the ij entry of that matrix, well, I'll just replace, right? It's going to be the sum over K, and I've got the transpose. So I need to flip these two indices. So it's going to be A, K, I, right? And now the P matrix is the same as A, so it's going to be A, K, J. Okay? Just substituting what it is. Now, what is the trace of A transpose A? What is the trace of a matrix? Well, it's defined here. It's the sum of the diagonal entries. So that's going to be the sum of the diagonal entries. The diagonal entries are the I entries, right? The sum over I. But I have the entry ij here, so I just substitute. So this is just sum over I. and sum over k of a k i. That's right, because now I need to replace I and j are now the same because it's ii. And this is now the sum over I and k of a k I squared, which is that once I replace k by j. Okay? Okay, so that's a good property to know, and we're going to be using traces all over the place. So getting used to working with matrices and traces and all that, it's going to take some practice, but you know, eventually you will remember this. You probably learned this 3 years ago, or whenever you took linear algebra. You probably remember it more than me, because I did it like 100 years ago. Okay, so another little trick that we'll use often is if I have a... maybe I should have said that before doing that, that the trace of AB is equal to the trace of BA. If the matrices are all square, I can reshuffle the order and of the multiplication, and the trace is the same. Obviously, AB is not the same as BA. The matrix product is not commutative. But once you take the trace, it gives you the same. So let me show you a neat application that we'll use every now and then of these. Is the following. So if you write X transpose AX. Okay, so A is a square matrix. X is a vector. That quantity, X transpose AX, is that a vector, is that a matrix, is that a scalar, what is it? It's a scalar, right? Because this is 1 by n, this is n by n, and this is n by 1, okay? So do you agree that a scalar and the trace of a scalar are the same thing? Right? Not much of a change. But now that I've written that, I can move the x from there to there and write like this. Okay. So that's one application of these tricks that we're going to be using. And so I can. The idea is that we're going to convert optimization problems over all of the training sets into things that just involve matrices. So let me give you one last application of these tricks. Suppose that I had an optimization problem that was maybe something like minimize sum of xi minus u times y, for example, minimize with respect to u, 2 n squared, I is 1 to n, okay? That's, in fact, we're going to see that much more clearly in the next lecture, but it's going to be really fitting a subspace to data. But by and large, I give x is data, let's say I give you y is also data, and I'm asking you to find u. And typically, this is sum from 1 to the n. This is like for each data point, you have examples. And now when you do optimization, you could start writing down things with all of these gazillion big summations. But you could start realizing that this is the same thing by using this property here. The Frobenius norm is equal to the sum of the squares of the entries. Frobenius norm is equal to the sum of the squares of the entries. I and j. But this is the same thing as saying the sum over I of just the norm of A of the jth column. So using this property. A matrix there, minus U times another matrix here, is going to be just the all of the data points in X, and Y is going to be all of the data points in Y, where X is going to be just the all of the data points in X, and Y is going to be all of the data points in Y. So instead of writing things point by point in long equations, we're going to start writing things as matrices and norms of matrices. Does everybody, who does not see why this is equal to that? Okay. So, this is x1, xn, minus u, y1, yn. You see that? Is that clear? So, and now, these are matrices. And I need to compute the Frobenius norm square. What is that? It's the sum of the square of the entries. But you could also think of it as the sum of the square of the columns. So now go column by column. It's going to be the first minus u times the first square, plus the second minus u times the second column square, plus the last one minus u times the last one, norm square. That's exactly what this says. The ith minus u times the ith to norm square. So it's exploiting exactly this property. That, sorry, huge typo here. At all.
What's the dot next to the J also?
It means that you consider all of the entries.
The whole row.
So is that, so effectively, this is A dot one, comma, A. Comma A dot N.
So it's like the colon in that line.
The colon. Yes. Yes, exactly. Yes.
Can you explain how you follow that arrow from the minimization to representing as capital X minus U Y?
Capital X? Excuse me, say it again?
That arrow on the side from the first line to the third line.
Yes.
Can you just explain that?
Ah. So let me start actually this way to that way is easier. So X is just the concatenation of all. I'm going to take a matrix X and divide it into its columns. And there are n columns. I'm going to take Y and I'm going to divide it into the n corresponding columns. Okay? So X minus U times Y is equal to just, I spell out that minus U times that. So now I need to compute the Frobenius norm of this matrix, which is the difference of these two things. Right? By definition of the Frobenius norm of a matrix, is equal to the sum of the two norms squared of the columns. So I just need to go column, so given this matrix, I just need to extract the ith column of it. The ith column of this one would be xi, the ith column of this one would be u times y. Okay? And therefore, minimizing or doing anything with this matrix gradient quantity, or doing it column by column, is the same thing. And this will be the typical thing that will show up in when we formulate problems, because we're going to be learning over data. And here is going to be data point by data point, and we're going to minimize the sum of the squares of the error by one. Instead of doing that, we're going to start trying to write things in terms of matrices, so that we don't need to be doing summations every single day of the class. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to go from linear algebra working with individual coordinates to just operating on matrices. Okay, thank you. I'll see you.
Yeah.